let's start with the, in general, I wanted to have a brief introduction. This is just one slide about things I've been working on, and our different types of ecosystems. I'm looking at the interaction between water-related processes and the role they play in the dynamics of ecosystems. This area of research, when I started about 4 years ago, we started calling this eco-hydrology. And I've been working mostly in desert environments, but more recently also in shallow coastal lagoons, mangroves, wetlands, and dry tropical forests. And today I will be talking mostly about work done in this part of the world, so in the Karahai. But what is common to these projects is the idea of looking at the plant community and the way it's affected by the physical environment. It could be rainfall, temperature, cloudiness, dust, and then how the plant community affects the physical environment itself through a mechanism of feedback. Most of the times we will be looking at feedbacks that involve water, because this is something that you are more interested in. And the interesting thing is that the feedbacks are positive, so the plant community benefits from a certain habitat that modifies the habitat to its own advantage. And this phenomenon is called in the ecology literature as ecosystem engineering, and can lead to interesting nonlinear dynamics. So we have the biota, we have the physical environment, and the ability of the biota to improve the physical environment. And then when we lose the biota, there is a loss of habitat, which could prevent the same community to re-establish. And so now we are looking at this framework, mostly in the context of desertification, and what affects the stability and resilience of arid landscapes. So most of you are engineers, and so you know when a system is stable. So when you perturb its state, it goes back, and you move the perturbation, it goes back where it was before. Then the resilience is an attribute of one of the stable states of the system, which means that tells us how easily that state can be recovered after a perturbation. So in this case, I always like to show the fact that this is more resilient than this one, because if we have only one stable state, regardless of the size of the magnitude of the disturbance, the system will recover, go back to that state at the end when we remove the perturbation. Instead, if the system has two alternative stable states, there is a critical threshold beyond which, if the magnitude of the perturbation exceeds that threshold, the system diverges to an alternative state, and at the point in which you remove the disturbance, you will not go back. So these concepts that are not due to engineers, who have been revisited and reformulated by the ecology community, in more general terms, by saying that in general, the resilience is the ability of the system to absorb or to cope with a perturbation without changing qualitatively its configuration. So, in the context of desertification, there has been quite a bit of literature trying to show that in many cases, arid landscapes are very fragile, have a low resilience, and if you perturb the vegetation in these systems, because of these positive effects I've been talking about, the system goes in the direction of a more degraded, we will say, state of vegetated vegetation, or with a different type of vegetation that, but in a condition that is more degraded. And today we will see what causes this bistable behavior and what can eliminate this bistability in a system. So, in general, in the context of desertification, we have that the perturbation could come from overgrazing, could come from logging, from the conversion of a rangeland into a cropland. This affects some properties of the system. Many times it could be just a loss of vegetation cover, which triggers processes that affect the physical environment and lead to, again, to a loss of habitat. So in very general terms, desertification can be defined as a process in which there is a change either in soil properties, in plant communities, in climate, that affects in a very persistent way the ability of the ecosystem to deliver some ecosystem services. And ecosystem services are then lost in a very permanent way. So with this I'm referring that it's a very almost irreversible transition, at least within the time scale of a few human generations. So the concept, even the idea itself of desertification, became popular already in the 70s and 80s, and then it has been challenged because of a number of reasons. First, basically, desertification is the conversion of a system to desert-like conditions. There isn't only one type of desert, there are many types of deserts, so by itself the definition is not very effective because there are deserts with different characteristics. And there isn't one mechanism that determines this shift to desert-like conditions, but there are several. So desertification is not very distinctive of processes or not even of the terminal state of this transition. Nevertheless, I think it's a useful concept or a term that most people would understand what you're talking about when you use it. So there are three major mechanisms of desertification. One is related to loss of vegetation that leads to land degradation, to be erosion, to be salt accumulation on the soil surface. And this is a mechanism that has been studied mostly by the soil science community. Then there are other mechanisms that involve impacts of losses of vegetation on climate. For example, you remove vegetation from Sahel, you affect the patterns of precipitation, you modify the climate, and then you remain locked in a state that is with no vegetation. And this has been studied mostly by the atmospheric science community. And then there are other mechanisms that involve changes in plant community composition. For example, from grasslands to shrublands, this has been happening all over the world. Or the effect of invasive grasses that displace native vegetation, and then but their ability to cover the land surface is less effective, and so they trigger indirectly a process of erosion. So today we will look at examples at these two examples, and I will look I will provide some examples at different scales. We will look first at the feedback between soil moisture and vegetation. Then we will look at the impact of interannual rainfall fluctuations, and then we will look at the example of the Kalahari and then possible indicators that tell us how close the system is to shifting to these desertified conditions. So the soil moisture vegetation feedback is a feedback in which we have that we find, this has been observed in many places, there is a wetter soil under the plant canopy than in a bare soil. And this could be, at least at the surface, this could be due to the fact that the presence of plants increase the infiltration capacity in some places, or they reduce evaporation from the soil surface. But what is important for us is that more soil moisture, so if we remove vegetation, we lose, so there is an increase in soil moisture, and this could be critical and prevent the re-establishment of vegetation. And since this feedback involves soil properties, to study this type of mechanism, it's important to put ourselves in a place where there is a gradient of precipitation to see how the hydrologic conditions may affect these dynamics, but on a homogeneous soil. We need to work in a place where the soil properties and the physical properties of soils are the same. And the ideal place, one of the few places on Earth where this is possible, is really in the Kalahari, where there is a sand sheet, this is one of the biggest in the world, that spans along a rainfall gradient. Here there are less than 200 millimeters of rain, which is where I did part of my research, to more than 1,000. And today we will look mostly at this lower part. And so what is interesting is that in this place we can make some measurements, and this is some work we did years ago. We placed soil moisture sensors under the canopies of trees in the intercanopy areas at different depths. And we had replicates for each site, and we had three or four sites. So we had four sites, but one of them we lost the instrument. So this we report here the difference in soil moisture between plots under the canopy and in the open areas. And we see that there is a positive difference that increases as we decrease the minimum annual precipitation. Then we can use okay, so we can find other ways to measure this that is more integrated over a long time period. And we looked at the soil profile. In this soil profile, so you identify layers which are richer in carbonates, which in fact you find that it's all sand, and then layers with carbonates. This tells you how deep water infiltrates into this profile, which is a good proxy for soil moisture or for an integrated soil moisture in the soil column. And we did again plots made dark soil pits in under the canopies and in open areas. No big differences in the weather at the wetter sites, but substantial differences at the drier sites. So the take home message is that there is a soil moisture feedback, so there is more soil moisture under the canopy, and this difference is stronger in the more arid sites. So we can then look at a very simple model to see how, speculate on how this can affect the dynamics of vegetation. This is a logistic growth, so V is a plant biomass, and it increases over time proportionally to the biomass present in the system, and also to the resources left available by the existing biomass. So this term here is called the carrying capacity, the maximum biomass per unit area that you can sustain in the certain landscape. And it depends on the limiting resources, in this case would be soil moisture. So we can assume that the typical shape for this carrying capacity is a function of average soil moisture, would be something like this. It saturates at high values of average soil moisture because at that point other factors would limit growth. And then we have the feedback. So the average soil moisture we have seen is a function of vegetation cover. We can take a straight line. If we combine all this information together and we look at the stable states of this system, we find that there is a function of annual precipitation. We find that there is an interval of or a range of annual precipitation values in which the dynamics can have two possible stable states. The system can be stable either in a vegetative condition or in a condition with no vegetation cover. Of course, this is a model that can always be criticized. It's a very naive and simplistic model just to stress how this nonlinear dynamics can lead to the emergence of a stable system. And the interesting thing is that if you are this ecosystem here, that this sits on the top of this bifurcation point, you need just a small change to determine a big transition to a state that is non-vegetated, which stresses the fact that this system is really not very resilient. We just need to remove a little bit of vegetation, and according to this model, the system would shift to an unvegetated state in almost a way that is almost irreversible, because then we would need to increase precipitation exceeding this point here to destabilize the desert state. These are just simplified models, but they stress the importance of these feedbacks. And then we see that if we use as a parameter beta that I showed before, which would be the slope of this line, and represents the strength of the feedback, we see that this bistable dynamics exists only when the strength of the feedback exceeds a physical value. So, what we learn from this is that the positive feedback between soil moisture and precipitation and vegetation determines this bistable behavior. And so, in sites that have a stronger feedback and a lower mean annual precipitation, vegetation is very particularly vulnerable. These sites are at the desert margins. And what I showed before is that the feedback is stronger really at the desert margins. So, just to convince you that if anywhere this feedback could play a role in determining the bistable behavior and the vulnerability of plant ecosystems, it's really at the desert margins. Which is different probably from what many people would think in the sense that everybody would expect that the arid places are more affected by desertification. But here what we are showing that is that the response would be non-linear, would be abrupt, and so there is a non-continuous change in vegetation as we decrease the amount of precipitation. So now the next question is, what is the, so far we have been thinking in terms of average response during average precipitation, but what is the impact of variability? There is an important property of desert climates, that is the variability. If we take, and these are based on the reanalysis data, but if we look at some rainfall gradients, this is the Guinea Sahel gradient, goes from like 100 to more than to about 2000 millimeters. You see that there is, as we move towards more arid places, the variability of precipitation increases. This is the coefficient of variation, so it's the standard deviation over the mean. Same thing in the Kalahari, we have been looking at before. We see that as overall, the variability is stronger in the more arid places. So what is the effect of variability? If we expect, if we have a dynamical system that is forced by an external driver, if we increase the variability of the driver, the trigger effect of this noise would be to increase the variability in the state of the system. And this is the so-called disorganizing effect of noise, which is pretty trivial and interesting. But in the physics literature, we find this notion of noise-induced transitions. The idea is that if we increase the variance of an external forcing, the nonlinear way in which this forcing interacts with the state of the system leads to the emergence of counterintuitive dynamics, which could be new bifurcations, new stable states, even by stable behavior, or properties, even special patterns can be induced by this external variability. So it's not just random fluctuations, but are organized behaviors. This idea appeared also in the natural science and in the also the hydrology literature. In fact, a paper that I think many of you could enjoy reading is this paper by Ecology to Red et al. 1991 is in Water Resources Research, and it presents some of these ideas that are related to a different type of coupling between soil moisture and atmosphere, and shows that as you increase the external variance, you go from dynamics that only one stable states into dynamics that can have alternative stable states. Of course, there are many weaknesses also in that model because it's simplistic, but there are some ideas that, particularly for that time, were very, very interesting and have been revisited many times since then. In the eco-hydrology literature, there are other examples, and then just to do some propaganda, years ago we wrote this book with the colleagues in Torino, in which we reviewed different applications of these notions to the environmental sciences. And so the idea is this type of area of research, which is the stochastic differential equations, where in a non-trivial way, basically noise plays a role and can lead to bifurcations, special patterns, etc. So the idea now is that since deserts are affected by strong variability, we can see how this variability could affect the feature, that feature. This is a study that goes through the detail, and with this study we show that because of the effect of external fluctuations, if we add a stochastic term to that system, we find that we replace dynamics that have two alternative stable states with some types of dynamics that have only one stable state. So the system is stabilized in the middle. And so, which means, if we go back to the initial feature, is that we replace the deterministic bistable system with a stochastic system with only one stable state. So the effect of noise is to increase the resilience of this system. And then we find that even more complex simulations, this is work by other people, the Zeng and Mirin, they used a coupled climate vegetation model, and they showed that basically over Africa, these shaded areas are the areas where the dynamics are bistable. So depending on whether you initialize the model with a forest or with a desert, the system converges to different states. But then if instead of using constant external force, a constant system temperature, if we add some fluctuations to this external forcing, basically it's the temperature here in this part of the sea, they find that in Southern Africa there is the disappearance of this bistable domain, and it also shrinks a lot in the northern hemisphere, indicating that the external forcing has really this effect of destroying the bistability. So, then an important question you might ask is, okay, now, how do we even know when we are when we look at the landscape, whether this landscape is bistable, whether if we remove, for example, vegetation from a certain area, it will never recover again. So, there is a literature that came out in the last few years, mostly in the context, mostly models, or mostly the only interesting applications I've seen are through the case of lakes that also can exhibit alternative to different attractors. And the users develop some indicators that can tell you how close, whether you are approaching this bifurcation point. So, they tell you whether the system, the way you are managing the system, is leading to a condition that is about to shift to collapse. And problem of this approach is that the terrestrial systems, they evolve very slowly. It's very hard to have statistics of vegetation cover in deserts because the desertification process, if we accept this term, doesn't happen overnight, but it will take 50 years, 20 years, or something. So we don't have data for anything like this. So, the other big problem is that, you see, those methods tell you something on how the system behaves as it approaches, as I just did, that nodes of that bifurcation. In the case of desertification, many times, we are dealing not for with a slow variable like minimum precipitation. The big driver is really land use, which means that someone goes there and abruptly removes a certain amount of vegetation. There is no theory that can tell us that whether this land use is bringing us very close to this shaded line, that dashed line that separates the two attractors. So, what we did in this case it was to find other more physical based processes. And so we are looking at this part of Africa. This was this is the typical, again, in the Kalahari, this is a typical dune in that area. And then if you go closer to the farm, or to the basically the house of this rancher, we find that the vegetation has been completely lost. And this is a big dune, and basically this guy, we know him, we work in his land many times, his house is buried by this dune. And this happened in the 70s because this is a typical thing that happened all over the world. As soon as these engines became relatively cheap, people started digging wells, and they thought in this way they could feed more cattle or more goats and sheep. So they built the stocking race of their rangeland. The limiting factor was not drinking water for the animals, but was really the grass. And so they lost all the glass in a few decades. So is this transition irreversible? So to do this, one indicator could be the seed bank. If we go there and collect the soil, put these, are there enough seeds for grasses to germinate? So we collected seeds, we did this type of analysis. This is done by looking at how many seeds germinate and also how many seeds in general we have. And what we find is, if you, I would like to drive you through this slide, this is means vegetated. We find germinating seeds only in vegetated sites. Wherever it's bare soil, it doesn't germinate. This is done also ungerminated seeds. You see, bare soil, there are none, and there are more where there is some vegetation. Which means that once the landscape becomes bare, it's very hard for these annual grasses to grow. Because just to give you an idea, in grasslands there are basically two types of grasses. Annual grasses that are reproduced by seeds, and then there are perennial grasses that mostly reproduce from roots. Also from seeds, but more easily from roots. And so if we did the some observations capitalizing on a grazing exclusion project that happened in the area of Botswana. This is from Google Earth. You see the fence out this area, and they saw that the grass was growing back. And so this would be outside the fence. This is a nice park and dune. If you go inside, you find this type of vegetation. And this is another site where this was done. And so by fencing, they noticed that the grasses were going back. This would suggest that then this system is able to recover. What recovers is not are not the annual grasses that grow from the seeds, but are the perennial grasses. And in fact, when we sampled the grasses inside these fences, we found that this is the percentage of the land that recovered, and this, we see that most of the grasses that recover are perennial. So this tells us something, a more direct experiment, that the system, this type of system can recover. And what recovers are first the annual grasses, and then the perennial grasses, and then eventually also the annual grasses will be back. And this is a talk I usually give to more ecology audiences, so I don't want to bore you with this, but just to give you an idea of the sequence of processes. When you have no grazing, you have a mixed perennial and annual grasses. You introduce the goats or sheep or whatever, and then they eat first the perennial grasses because they are richer in proteins. And then you keep grazing, you lose all the perennials, and they will start feeding on the annuals. If you, at some point, interrupt grazing, you can recover. But if you let it go, most likely, you are not going to be able to recover. Although we were not able to see reach that stage. This is the reason why I present this is because sometimes we like to talk about theories of stability, but it's nice also to have experiments that can tell us something. So this could be a way to see whether a certain landscape can recover. The other interesting aspect of desertification are possible teleconnections. So desertification doesn't affect only the place or the farmer of that man I was talking about, but it can have broader effects on the global scale. And so what we have been doing is also to get teleconnections between the desertification and nearby ecosystems. And we will look in particular at the Southern Ocean. This is the availability of nutrients, I don't remember what, but I think the productivity of the Southern Ocean. And we observe that this ocean has a very low productivity. Not because there are no nutrients, there is enough nitrogen there, but there are areas called high nutrient but low productivity that are missing ion. Ion usually into the ocean is provided by the land masses. And the problem is that the Southern Ocean doesn't have many land masses around it. You know, the other big problem is that most of the dust on Earth is emitted from the Northern Hemisphere. These dots are major dust sources on Earth. And you see that they are mostly in the Northern Hemisphere. And according to some studies, about 90% of the dust emitted, that would be the yellow lines here, are emitted by Northern Hemisphere sources, mostly from North Africa, we will be talking about it later. And this area here of the so-called Bodella Depression is the main dust source. This means that in the Southern Hemisphere there isn't much happening, but one of the interesting questions could be, how about the impact of global environmental change? Are we going to see new dust sources become active in the next few years? So what is their possible impact? And so since we were looking at the Calamari, we did an analysis of trajectories, the trajectories in the atmosphere, they are coupled with atmospheric models, and we see that the Southern Ocean could be affected by dust emissions from that part of the world. And another area that is affected, and we will be talking about this later, is Australia. So even though there are no major dust sources right now, it could be that after some land use change, some dust sources are produced many times. Our problem is that we don't have a way to see dust that is not emitted now, because there is still some vegetation. And the idea is to try to see what could happen if that vegetation is lost. So we cannot rely on satellite images because there are no dust plumes yet coming out of certain regions. Oh, I did something wrong. Okay. So what we did is we have my universe had built a dust generator, which is a machine where we take some soil samples from different parts of the world. We put it in this machine and we try to rank them based on their ability to produce dust. And so it's a simple thing. So it's based on the design done by the wind erosion lab of the U.S. Department of Agriculture. And there is a tube that rotates. I don't even see the tube here. It is. You put the sample inside. Then there is a tube that draws air from this vertical cylinder. And so by rotating, it releases dust. So this dust is drawn with it into this chamber where there is an aerosol analyzer. And then we do this measurement with the same protocol for different samples, so we can see who is better than others in producing dust. And we can collect samples from areas that are vegetated, so they could still have fine particles, areas that are bare, and then these dry lakes that, this is a lake, I think it was on the size of most of Switzerland in Botswana. It is nearly one of the major dry lakes in that region. And then the sediments are very silty, so they can produce a lot of dust. Similarly, we have done this analysis for the Mandi region of Australia. It's, this part of Australia has been responsible for land use and agriculture in that region. It's been responsible for dust emissions that affected and dust storms that affected the city of Melbourne a few years ago. So, and even dust from this part of from this region could affect again the Southern Ocean. When we look at the dust generating potential of these different sites, this is from Southern Africa, this would be from the Mali, we see that they are pretty much similar. And then we also characterize that they are soluble ion contents. But so we see that there are implications that are not only local but could be global, and at some point it becomes speculative because we can only see how much dust, how important that source of dust would be, how much ion we can have, but we don't have we cannot have direct measurements of what happens to the productivity of the Southern Ocean. Even though the chemical oceanographers have done some ion utilization experiments in the region, in the Southern Ocean, and they've seen that by adding ion, there is an increase in productivity. And the paleoclimate records tend to show that in periods in the Earth history where the Southern Hemisphere was drier, there was a higher productivity in the Southern Ocean. So the last feedback I'm going to talk about is between dust and precipitation. I think, I'm not good with names, I think Karina is you, the girl from Milano. Karina is your name, right?
Yeah.
Katia, sorry. Yeah. So anyway, Katia, you were showing something related to dust and precipitation, etc. So the idea is very similar. So, in an interesting paper, more than 10 years ago, Rosenthal noticed that there could be an interesting desertification feedback that involves dust emissions. So, less rainfall, less vegetation, more atmospheric dust, and suppression of precipitation by dust. So, this is a positive feedback that affects the interactions with the atmosphere and with the rainfall. And what we did a few years ago was to study these dynamics. So, if anywhere again in the world, I think the Sahel would be the region where this feedback would play an important role, because it's very close to major dust sources and it's very much affected by dust. So the Sahel is this great land where there is vegetation. The Sahara doesn't have much vegetation, so we don't expect that to be part of this feedback involving also vegetation dynamics. But it's very close to this white dot, which is the Bodelli depression, and it's a major source. This is these are dust emissions from this region, and we see the Bodelli is the big player because there is more wind, and also the sediments are particular. These are diatomite sediments, which are very fine. And this region has been affected by long droughts. The drought of the Sahel affected the last 30 years of the century, and has been considered one of the mega droughts of last century. In fact, there is a rich literature on this phenomenon that goes from the climate space sciences, also to the human sciences, because of this notion of environmental driven migrations, and we Italy in a way is also affected by that. So for like 30 years there has been below average precipitation. This affected the livelihoods of many people. So this is, and again, when there is a persistent anomaly, we tend to think that there is something that keeps the system in that state, like it's a positive feedback. And this feedback affects also interactions between the Sahel and this part of the Sahara, which is called the Sahara heat flow, in the sense that there is an anomaly of temperature here that weakens the flow of moisture from the Guinea Gulf into inland. And the typical vegetation precipitation feedbacks in this region have been studied more in the terms of albedo. In fact, Charney, who is basically one of the fathers of this literature on land atmosphere interactions, argued that deserts are brighter, so they reflect more light, and so they absorb less heat, so there is less convection, and this would weaken again precipitation. This is a rich literature, we are not dealing with that now, we are looking at the direct impact of dust on precipitation. So what we did, with many of these feedbacks, the big problem is that you cannot have an experiment to test things very well. So if I pick a city, if I pick Dakar, and I take measurements of precipitation and dust in Dakar, and I find that dustier years are drier years, you can tell me, yeah, there is more dust because there is less rainfall, while I'm trying to say the opposite, there is less rainfall because there is more dust. So to solve this problem, what we did was to look at, to relate, we had rainfall records on these cities, relate rainfall in these cities to dust in the upwind from the cities. So we ran some, again, back trajectory, in this case, algorithms for 1 or 2 days, and we created rainfall here to dust in upwind from that point, 1 or 2 days upwind. So it will be hard to say that the rainfall here today affects the dust 2 or 3 days before in another days. Then there are problems because there are spatial and temporal autocorrelation, but this is the best we can do. So we, with this type of analysis, what we found is that the precipitation is inversely related to dust levels. And this is based on a dust aerosol product, which is called satellite data from, it's called the TOMS. And so we can say that there is a feedback. Of course, there's a lot of spread, and we need to acknowledge that. So what we have now is that we can see how this feedback can lead to bistability. This has been the theme for this talk. We said that more dust gives less precipitation. This is based on the study we have done in this paper. Then less precipitation, less vegetation, we need to close this loop. To model the impact of precipitation on vegetation, we use this model that has been developed really for the day to study the vegetation and climate interactions in the Sahel. So this is again very similar to what we have seen before, a linear growth in this case with the kind of capacity that depends on precipitation with a nice shaped function like this. And this is taken from the literature. And then we need to know how vegetation affects dust. To do this, what we have done, we can look at atmospheric dust, a mass balance for dust. So if this is the atmospheric dust concentration, it changes over time because of an imbalance between emissions and deposition. And then Z would be the thickness of the so-called dust layer in the atmosphere. And so we have the deposition. Makes sense to say that it's like a linear reservoir, so we release the release of dust is proportional to the amount of dust present in that layer. And then the emissions we see how we can represent those. Now, if we take long-term conditions since the residence time of dust in the area is just 1 week at most. If we take a seasonal average, look at the equilibrium conditions, we can say that the average emission is equal to the deposition rate. And the emissions now depend on two possible sources of emissions. There are endogenous sources that are from the Sahel, and there are sources from the Sahara. There is a difference between the two, because here we have vegetation, so there could be a feedback to vegetation, while in the Sahara there is no feedback on vegetation. And so we have two different sources. We can say that Q represents a way to indicate the relative importance of internal and external sources of dust. Now, the internal sources depend on vegetation, so what we have done was to collect measurements of dust fluxes with different vegetation covers. So we consider sites that are vegetated dunes, dunes with sparse vegetation, and then bare dunes. And then in each one of them, we place these collectors. These are just collectors that have a wind vane, so when there is a wind blowing, they are aligned in the direction of the wind. And then from this inlet, they collect dust. We made some measurements with different vegetation covers, and then the vertical fluxes are usually, there is a way to calculate this, are proportional to the horizontal fluxes. And so we obtain this type of relationship. Again, there is a lot of spread, but there is nothing surprising basically that on a bare soil you are going to have more dust emissions. And we can, the difference this, between a bare dune and a vegetative dune, these are different scales, you see orders of magnitude of difference. So when we put all these things together and we can look at the stable states of the system, we can we find this type of relationship. So we see that the system can be stable in many of these cities in a vegetative state, but if we remove vegetation and the feedback is stronger than a certain magnitude, we have that because of this feedback, the system can remain locked in an unvegetated condition because of a decrease in precipitation that we assume is associated with the dust levels in the atmosphere. And clearly there are many weaknesses here. This is a very simplified and toy model, just to advance some hypotheses that of course would require a more sophisticated approach. But then we said that Q is the ratio between external and internal sources. If the external source doesn't depend on vegetation, it's something that overall weakens this feedback, because basically this is the supply of dust that we have regardless of whether it's vegetated or not. If we see that if we have more external sources, we can have the system by the dynamics become quite stable, because there will be so much dust that the rainfall is always suppressed, which is not what we observe, because we observe that there is vegetation in the Sahel, at least in wet areas. So then there is another thing that I wanted to stress, the inverse relationship between precipitation in the Sahel and dust emissions in the Sahara. Because years with more rainfall in the Sahel are associated with years with lower wind speed in the Sahara, and so less dust emissions. So this is due to the fact that during those the wet years, there is the establishment of during the dry years, there is the establishment of this anti-cyclonic circulation, that, and then we can see the emissions from this area. These are anomalies in wind speed, which are of opposite signs with respect to the wind speed pattern in the weather years that are shown here. Worry with this. So this is the typical pattern, these are wind speeds. The anomalies with respect in the dry years are in the opposite direction. So overall, there is a decrease in wind speed in this region. So a decrease in emissions. And if we account for this effect, we find that, I hate that we go this way, there is a negative relationship between wind speed in the dust source and the precipitation. And so, just to conclude now, we can see that in general, we will be looking at the effect of positive hydrologic feedbacks and the impact they can have in dynamics of desertification. As a general framework, we have seen that there is an exogenous driver and then an internal feedback, something that interacts with the dynamics of the system. And we have seen that the effect of noise is to smoothen these dynamics and destroy this bistable behavior, which is which is what would make the process of desertification unpredictable, unexpected, irreversible, etc., and very discontinuous. We said that for systems away from equilibrium, there are no easy indicators that can tell us how close the system is to this bifurcation point. So we don't have a theory to investigate them, but I've shown you some experiments that can give us some indications. And then we will look at different ways of looking at these mechanisms of land-atmosphere interactions that could be associated with desertification. Instead of having this dichotomy between atmospheric feedbacks and land degradation feedbacks, this dust emission process brings them together. And this is an area of research that is becoming quite popular and I think also interesting because it can tell us something more than the typical impact of vegetation on the atmosphere associated with water vapor fluxes. So in general, we look at the system as many natural systems have interesting interactions between the biota and the physical environment. But one way in which I think at least a part of our field of research is moving is to look at the interactions with the societies, which again can be mutual interactions. Societies affect and exert a certain pressure on the natural environment, and here the natural, we depend on the natural environment. So, in which shape also dynamics of societal dynamics. And the other interesting aspect that we see is that so there is a literature emerging on these social environmental systems, and but we don't have only these systems are not isolated. There are mechanisms that of globalization that make them interact together, and this is an interesting area in my view of research because now. The demand of biofuels in Europe are causing deforestation in Indonesia or Malaysia. So there are teleconnections that are more sophisticated because involve societal dynamics, economics, etc. More sophisticated than the simple transport of dust to the Southern Ocean I've been talking about. And so, in the context of hydrology, we have different colleagues also in Italy, the groups in Torino, we have been looking at this trade of recalled water, and I know here there is a Marta, I think she gave a talk on something related to that. So there are teleconnections that that are associated with trade and in the vehicle transport of water. There are other mechanisms of globalization that are not associated with trade, but are associated with international investments in land. This is an area of research I've been working on with Cristina Rulli in Milano, and I think David presented something on the first day. So there are other mechanisms that create this coupling. And then it's interesting to see that when we account for this distribution, we are also in a better position to look at the way societies depend on local versus virtual resources, so resources that are available locally or available through international trade. And so one of the mechanisms of desertification that could be explored is really how the pressure of societies from different parts of the world are causing land degradation in another region. And another area of research that I've been working on with colleagues in my environment are related to human rights, how this redistribution affects equality and the access to natural resources. So with this, I'm done, and I thank you for your attention. Thank you.
thank you, Paolo, for this inspiring presentation. I think if I would be still a PhD student, I would intend to change my career.
I'm sorry that I'm out of time, slide, but yeah.
But I think we can still have some questions, of course.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Hi.
Thank you for your very interesting and very good presentation.
Speak loudly.
This is.
Over here. Stand up, maybe.
This idea of system shift, you are looking at it at a relatively local scale. What do you think about its upgrading to a planetary scale, as we try to do when I saw your citation, you tried to shepherd about this concept of planetary boundaries, where you think in terms of different stages of the planet? And
yeah, that's more than Schaeffer is a rock strong.
But they had the 2015.
That's an interesting point. So the question is whether this shift might be not only at a small scale, but could be at a global scale. I think we need to go by steps. I think also some of these feedbacks that determine this possible emergence of alternative stable states operate at different scales. So if you're looking at the example of soil moisture, clearly at the patch to landscape scale. If you're looking at already a feedback of precipitation, I think you need to go like the example of Sahel or people studying the Amazon basin, etc. You need to go to a much larger scale, so in order to affect precipitation, it's not enough that you want the grass in your backyard, but you need to affect the scale of several hundreds of thousands or also thousands of kilometers. Now, going to the whole world, I think it becomes a little bit speculative, but it's an interesting direction to go. Whether our pressure on the water system, on the nitrogen, on the diversity, etc., is going to bring the humanity in a direction in which something is lost in a very irreversible way. So I think now the research in that area remains more as a general idea, but there is no, it's very hard to quantify these boundaries. Yeah, sure.
Well, the thing is that now they are proposing them as within the sustainable development goals. I mean, they are including this planetary boundary as a sustainable development goal. And there are also examples of downscaling these planetary boundaries at the national scale. They gave it for Sweden, for instance, to help downscale these planetary boundaries to the national scale, which might not have a really physical, I don't know what it is.
No, I should say, yeah, well, when they do that, I think my own problem is doing that is that, again, you need to realize that since the notion of planetary boundaries is pretty much tied to population and the pressure from the footprint of a certain society living within a country, there's a part of that footprint that is outside the country itself. And so that needs to be accounted for. But I think it's an interesting, in general, an interesting idea. My only thing is that sometimes when, how can I say it in a nice way, but basically, there is the tendency of creating very sexy ideas that are very difficult to apply, or also sometimes very and this is has been done in some of that work. For example, if you look at deforestation at the global scale, and then the type of analysis to show that there are two possible stable states, or and there is a shift between the two of them, has been done in a way that is quite questionable, because they have been looking. They did the space for time substitutions because nobody has time series. And they said, okay, with the same rainfall, you can have a forest and you have a grassland. But perhaps the reason why you have a forest and a grassland is not because there has been any shift, but only because there are different soils. So it's very hard to do extrapolations. And some of the work goes from the Arctic to the tropics. So it seems to be a little bit. But yeah, it's an interesting direction for sure.
Thank you.
Yes, Paolo, I think there are several things that one I miss one place is probably important is why dust is reducing rainfall. That's the
I can answer to that right away. So there are different effects. There are direct effects of dust on the radiation, because there is the fact that dust affects the carbon microphysics. So if you have too many carbon condensation in the ice, this is a very ineffective condensation. So you have limited moisture that is partitioned among too many carbon condensation in the ice. So you have the formation of clouds, but you never go from the droplet size, cloud droplet, to the rainfall droplet, because the coalescence or mechanisms don't take place. Coalescence or ice crystal growth, so are inhibited because of that. So you have, and this is one of the indirect effects. There is a more direct effect that is that since you have the clouds sitting there for a longer time and then it doesn't rain, so you have a cooling of the ground surface. In addition to the even more direct effect of more aerosols reducing the radiation on the ground surface, this limits the heating on the surface, convection, and so you can either act through cloud processes or through convection. Both ways you have less rainfall. This is the explanation.
Yeah, because the traditional things that you find in textbook is that if you don't have dust in the air, you don't have a coalition, so
but if you have too much, you're also screwed.
So there is
a place where there is a really lot of dust, so that dust will not be a limiting factor in the place. And if you go to some of these really very arid and windy places, you always have some haze and some.
Second question, if there is no other. This is anyway a global view of the world, in the sense that you
not global enough.
In fact, Bilal questions kind of reverse my what I was saying, but from the traditional hydrological point of view of seeing the things, you are dealing with a global scale, which means how Namibia is affects the South Oceans, or vice versa, how whatever else, teleconnection in another place affects actually the local things. So here, in any way, after the Bilal questions, something is kind of mixed between scales in all this game.
So there are local processes affecting large. The thing is always again we need to look at what is the scale that is relevant to different types of processes. And again, now I've been mentioning different types of processes that can lead again to a sustained change in vegetation. And so some processes are relevant at the patch scale, other processes. I haven't talked about the microclimate, for example. When you change the community, you can affect its microclimate. Deserts are also very cold places, and so you could have some woody plants, for example, are inhibited in their growth because of the change in microclimate. So there are many things, so that would be more of a landscape scale. And then if you go to the rainfall, you are not talking about microclimate, but about more like a divisional climate, or mesoscale also processes. And and in fact, would you touch on a very interesting point, because even in the deforestation literature, there is a tendency of noticing that if you deforest a small area, you can actually have an increase in local increase in precipitation because of the mesoscale circulation, etc. If you cut the forest of larger scale, you tend to have a decrease in rainfall. So I think there is the scales again are critical in determining the signs of the change.
Yeah, because probably I stopped to the the early works of, for instance, of Eagleson, when he says, yeah, there is this hydrological scale, which is kind of smaller than the scale where the water fluxes can affect the global circulation. But that is kind of mixing a kind of more variety that was expected.
We have two more questions. First of all, thank you for this very interesting, very broad presentation. My questions are basically two, as I said. The first one is related to the stable system that you presented. There are environments in which you may have two situations. One without vegetation, the other one with vegetation, and depending on the rainfall, basically. But this is in a natural condition. What happens if you have areas which are irrigated? Are they developing differently? Are they affecting also neighboring areas? Because in some way, in particular, if the area which is irrigated is large, and the amount of area that will be irrigated in the future is expected to increase, of course. How is the effect of this alteration of the natural cycle which is introduced by irrigation? This is the first question. Are there studies looking at...
So that these kind of studies open the way to a different sort of climate engineering. I mean, in the past,
So talking about irrigation, there have been studies since the 80s based on that, and then the typical example in this context would be the case of the Nile River, because you have a big river flowing through a desert. So different scenarios of irrigation, also some measurements that have been done at this point. And yes, there is an impact on the oil pipeline, because increase latent fluxes, increase water vapor, you can sustain more, you can intensify locally with the water cycle. So there is an impact of that. Then globally, the impact of irrigation is to reduce river flows and to increase the long transpiration. So the effect on the broader scale of the is that we have many rivers in the world that don't reach the ocean anymore because of water withdrawals for irrigation. And we have an increase in evapotranspiration.
But do you still have the possibility of these stable systems, or because of irrigation you move away from this situation?
I see what you say. Well, there are some people who have studied that. I don't know if they are addressed specifically in this question. Because, again, it depends on what creates this biostability. If the biostability is associated, again, with the water vapor fluxes and with the more, the so-called precipitation recycling paradigm, clearly, by irrigating more, you favor precipitation recycling. So this could even move the system more in the direction of a wet state.
Yeah.
Because you take the water from
First glance,
I think that would be the answer. Globally, there is also a bigger impact of irrigation. There could be a bigger impact of irrigation, not only in these very extreme situations, but all over the world. And I don't know the answer for that. What is the increase in irrigation, or the irrigation, in fact, the effect of irrigation in the Midwest and the United States on the local climate? But it has been studied.
Yeah, okay. The second question, if I can. It is related to the biofuel.
Okay.
I don't know the importance of the production of biofuels, but certainly it will require more irrigation in some way, and also it will require more nitrogen. So it will increase the production of nitrogen and also the discharge of the nitrogen the nitrogen for growing the crops. And this would create another feedback because nitrogen is also increasing the production of N2O, which is a greenhouse effect, which actually, of course,
you have more effect than CO2.
In your studies, the effect on nitrogen has not been introduced because you're looking at this
more water liquid systems. But if I can answer, so we have done a study that is a global scale on biofuels production and the water human appropriation of water resources due to biofuels. So in general terms, it's a lot, but it's not a lot. Just to give you an idea, it's like half or one third of the global depletion of groundwater, unsustainable depletion of groundwater, or it's much less than the water we use for irrigation overall, putting together rain fed and non-rainfed combined. So all that depends on where you grow the biofuels. So some of these biofuels are grown in, again, for biodiesel, so all the palm oil, there is a lot of discussion about that. That is grown in a place of the world where there is not much irrigation done, because it's are the wet tropics, Malaysia, Indonesia, etc. So there the water is mostly rainwater. Going more to the direction of emissions associated with that, they require quite a bit of nitrogen. And so that nitrogen, we can quantify it in different ways. From the hydrologists tend to, so nitrogen has the impact of really releasing pollutants in the water first. So that nitrogen, we can quantify that in terms of the so-called gray water. I don't know if this is a familiar concept here, but basically, if we release a certain pollutant, we can think that we need to leave in the river enough water for that pollutant to be diluted enough within an acceptable standard. So the amount of water required to dilute the pollutant is called the gray water footprint of that crop production. And so it's if you want to grow the crop sustainably without polluting beyond reasonable limits the environment, we need to have that water. And so it's a substantial amount of that water because it can be required quite a bit of nitrogen. Then the whole thing of carbon gains or carbon losses or impacts on climate, these analyses have been done for biofuels, so they require fertilizers that then are basically a reactive nitrogen, and these nitrogen oxides affect the greenhouse gases. In addition to that, often they are grown in a land that was it's clear that to be become a plantation. And so there is an additional carbon emission, in the case carbon, using the deforestation. Deforestation is a major contributor to carbon emissions. So it has been estimated that there is in the literature this notion of carbon debt. So before the production of biofuels is able to pay back the debt in terms of carbon emissions caused by deforestation, it could take, it depends on where it's gone, but between decades to centuries. So the so-called peat forests of Indonesia, they are by cutting the forest, peats clearly are rich in carbon, they are drained, they are, so the drainage goes. So that seems to be orders of magnitude bigger than it is an order of magnitude bigger than N2O.
N2O emission.
Yeah. But those are also important anyways, because then there is also energy associated with the production of fertilizer that probably should be factored.
Globally the emissions increases, so we are not reducing emissions because we use biofuel.
Yeah, or at least it will take some time to pay back the deforestation debt, and then we will not be all gain, but there will be some loss. And clearly, the gain would be more than the loss once we pay back the debt, but it's less than what was paid. So now the European Union passed a legislation, was I think in 2012, to allow to say, okay, it doesn't count towards the renewable energy requirement biofuel produced at the expenses of natural ecosystems, and then you need to factor in all these other factors. But then it's very hard to monitor this, because what is happening is the displacement. Okay, now I'm growing biofuels on the rangeland, and the rangeland will move into the forest. And so it will be very hard to find. Yeah.
Okay, Ricardo.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah, the question
was on the aquarium. Can you show us a model with the, that is unstable with two stable states? And I think that we want to avoid the desertification. And show that, of course, that this process can be reversible in some way. And can you use this type of model to give a prevision for the future and to keep safe some places that can be more feasible for revegetation or not?
That's a good question. Thanks for asking this. So I want to be very honest. I think these are very simplistic type models that are useful for us to develop hypotheses, to speculate on how things might work, and that's their main goal. Then I think that whenever it's possible, it's better to have straight experimental evidence about the facts of the recovery of the landscape or how it could behave under some different types of manipulation. In a way that you can say, okay, first of all, is this reversible or irreversible? So does it exist another stable state, that the so-called unwanted alternative state? That's the first thing. And then how close am I to this possible transition? And so I think the first step is to say, okay, in a very speculative way to say, okay, this process, A plus B plus C, can give us some flexible dynamics conceptually, because we have a positive feedback, and often a positive feedback can give is with some non-linearity this type of behavior. But then it's the best way is always to find some more direct evidence for that. Because clearly, I don't think we can explain the world with one equation. But I think it can be useful to more complex models are not any better, in my view, because they are over parameterized given the limited data available. And so sometimes we have are fully constrained, but also it's very hard to determine what causes what. So I think, and I want to prevent Ricardo's criticism because he's very opinionated about models. But yeah, you can always develop a better model, but at some scales, or at least there is a starting point. A model that captures processes, but clearly has its own limitations, could be a good starting point.
So I think the last question, maybe from the right wing.
The right wing, yeah.
Or the left wing, depending.
Ah, okay, yes.
There is no
right
wing.
I have a comment anyway.
You came from the other side.
Yeah, I sit on the other side, so... So, but Paolo, now we look at the students that we have here, and the idea is the scenario you show, but even we have different approaches, different, I think to our water science has, should be inclusive, maybe, so having different point of view, but...
And this is why you're a Franco-Tiratore.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, but at the same time, you seem also to draw the idea that one studying in our sciences is becoming more, I don't know, a global scientist, a global environment scientist, which is not anymore just looking at water or channels, a flume, or... but he's looking at the whole world and the very different processes. And so where you have a nitrogen cycle, but that is more traditional if you want to say that. But in a teleconnection, in interconnection with feedbacks of everything, and that's configure a different way also to teach engineer maybe, or to teach environmental engineering. Or to look differently for topics and things, and so.
I think it's always a matter of taste. There are people who like pears, people who like oranges. right? So it's that's my first thing. See, if you do this type of job, you can do something that you have passion for and something you like. And so, and something you find intriguing. And so that's, in my view, that should be, so the, I don't want to claim that doing more global and interdisciplinary studies is the place to be, or depends on the personal taste, depends on what people find some interest for. That would be the only rule I generally have also, because of the students in my group, some of them are more like this in a type of larger scale, etc. But I had also students who were more focused on specific questions. So I think the basic rule is, again, something you like, something you, it is new and that has not been done before. So if the student comes and say, okay, we need to do this because these other people are doing this, no, that's not the opinion. So trying to be at least in this selection of what you're doing non-incremental, and then the other thing is also possibly have the same perception of where there will be more interest within the academic community, because in America we have the criteria in which faculty members or postdocs etc. are selected is based on their ability to bring to a department something they don't have already. So if you if you get into a new field, it's easier for your application to get some attention. And so that would be the general rules. But this doesn't mean with these three elements, I don't think it doesn't mean to be global necessarily. Of course, it needs to be relevant, interesting, and novel. This is is this a good answer, Professor?
Yes, it is a good answer. But
so since this is a kind of anticipation of the discussion we are supposed to do later, maybe we can continue for 10 minutes and move fly again to the next block, because now can be we need some fresh air probably. So we can, if there are other questions, and then we will stop for half an hour and then Flavia will give a talk. So comments, especially on this, I would say, what's your impression about comparing what you are doing with this kind of broad picture? And okay, let's have a coffee and maybe we can.